Good evening and welcome to the postponed January Beach Commission meeting. Can I ask all to stand with the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening, everybody. Let me introduce the Beach Commission commissioners. To my far right, Fran McMahon, representing Rockingham Planning Commission. Rick Griffin, who is a selectman here in town, representing the town of Hampton. Bob Ladd, representing the Hampton Beach Village District. John Nyan, representing the town of Hampton. Ann Marchant, our secretary. Chuck Rage, representing the Hampton Beach Village District. Dean Merrill, Commissioner at Large. Mike Hausman, representing Dred State Parks. Bob Preston, representing the Chamber of Commerce. And Jason Bastan, who is a planner at Town Planner, who we asked to sit with us each meeting. We have one excused member tonight, and that's Bill Watson, who is not feeling very well. So he was excused later, earlier today. Let's move to public comment. Anybody in the audience for public comment? Mr. McDonald, please state your name and address, please.
Ed McDonald, 25 Epping Ave, summer resident only. I've lost a little bit of track on what's happening in the meetings and what's going on in the planning. So I just... curious as to what some of the comments that I made back in October of 2015 seem to have come up again, and I don't know where they've gone from there. One of the ones is one that Bob Preston brought up, I think, at one of the last meetings, was eliminating the U-turn at Ashworth Avenue and Ocean Boulevard. Mm-hmm. I had suggested that back in 2015, and had suggested a new configuration down near the Ocean Walk to allow people to stay on the State Pier Road, as I call it. I don't know what the name of that road is that goes down the State Pier, but go down the State Pier Road and open up an opening into the State Park and change that so that you'd go up the State Park Road, come to take a left turn, and you could either go straight into the State Park, take a right to go to Seabrook, or make a U-turn to go back on Ocean Boulevard. I don't know what happened to that. I hadn't seen any comments from the engineers on that suggestion. Several other things are the 90-degree parking. Changing 90-degree parking in the middle of the new configured parking area north of the Ashworth. You gain some space, gain some parking spaces, but it really should stay angle parking where it's a one-way going up that way. It just makes more sense. It's easier parking. It's less traffic congestion. Eliminating the two lanes on Ocean Boulevard, both north and south, north of the Ashworth, really doesn't make any sense at all. It's like taking 95 and saying, well, we want more capacity on 95, so we'll eliminate one lane. Eliminating those lanes is really going to screw things up. If you have an accident northbound on that one lane going northbound, right in the vicinity of Church Street, there's no way you're going to get around that. If you have somebody broken down, an accident, it's just... That just doesn't make any sense. I'd recommend that you stay with the two lanes in both directions, north and south of the Ashworth. I mean, north of the Ashworth. What happened to the idea of making Highland Ave one-way westbound? Is that ever discussed and decided on? Or?
When you finish your points, I'll try to.
Okay. All right. Was the traffic data ever corrected to include O Street, Epping Ave, and did they ever do any data collection for the entrance to the state park? It seems like a major intersection, but there is no traffic data on that. O Street also is kind of a main channel, if you will, from Ashworth up onto Ocean Boulevard, so you can get into the Haver Street parking area, and it O Street doesn't even exist on the traffic data. It's not there at all. Was there ever a consideration for making Brown Ave the entrance to the beach and reconfiguring it so that it would come out opposite F Street instead of having it come at a dead end where Charlie's East Street wants to be? If it was shifted over through the parking lot, the town parking lot, and come out opposite F Street, make F Street an up street, you could have a nice continuous flow of traffic from the expressway right up onto Ocean Boulevard, and you could still go on to Ashworth Avenue. I think you'd have to have it at signalized at an intersection, but something I don't know whether anybody had ever looked at. Two other recommendations that I made that I had not seen anything talked about were the making a causeway from, I said from Route 1 to the marina, but having it from Glade Path along the river to the marina, so you could connect all the west side streets to have a whole new road. Brown Ave was supposed to originally have gone further down. I don't know if it was to go all the way to the marina, but it was originally, at one point it had been designed to go down to further down south. What happened to that, I don't know, but putting a causeway along from the intersection of the expressway and Glade Path along the river down to the marina would allow the west side streets to become not dead end, and would also open up another roadway for the to take more capacity. And the other, which was a pie in the sky recommendation, but I hadn't heard any discussion, was pushing for a connector to 95 from 107. There's a fairly good clear pathway from 107 across the marsh to come into where the reconfigured bridge or the rebuilt bridge is going to be, and that's not going to remain forever. I had suggested it be considered when they were going for relicensing the nuclear plant, with the thought that maybe there was some money that the town or the state could get to build a connector to make a true emergency exit in case of the nuclear plant, and see if there was any money available to do that. I didn't hear any discussion whatsoever on that. The other thing was the suggestion that Chuck Rage had was to have a U-turn at the end of the parking lot at Boar's Head and eliminate going through the parking lot into Church Street. That seemed to make a whole lot of sense, but I don't know what happened to that suggestion. I haven't heard anything on that. That could have been not only a U-turn, but it might have been a rotary at the end of the parking lot. But like I said, I've lost a little bit of track. I've tried to keep up with it, but it's difficult finding stuff on DOT's website. I don't know why, but I have no luck finding anything on there. And the only comments or responses to comments I've seen are what you've provided in emails to me. So those are the suggestions. I'd just like to know what happened to some of the suggestions and why some were responded to and others weren't.
All right, let me try to respond, Ed. I'm not sure if I have all of the answers, but I'll do my best. First of all, the way the process went from all of the public hearings that we had and all of the comments, both verbal and written comments that individuals had, whether or not they were town officials, department heads, public safety, private residents, all of those statements were recorded and submitted into both DOT and to VHB. So that was number one. During that whole process, the commissioners here continue to review additional comments. For example, your emails to me went out to all of the commissioners. Any correspondence that you had sent to me did in fact go out to the commissioners for consideration. Back in October, we then had a kind of a final discussion to say, is there anything else that people want to bring up within the commission that was not in the final recommendations of VHB? Because we then had in November to make that final recommendation to VHB. So all comments at that point was documented, recorded, and everybody had the equal amount of information going into the November meeting. One of the things that came out of the November meeting in that discussion was that there was a lot of, let's just say, flexibility with regard to continuing to entertain comments, because the detailed design, the engineering detailed design, would be looking at different ways. And I'll give you a great example. Whether or not the north of the Ashworth parking was going to be 90 degree or, that's what I'm looking for, angled. That they were going to look at both ways from a space and cost. So those would be some of the things that, yes, there were certain individuals that made comments like that. The consensus was they liked the concept of the parking in that area. Whether or not it was angled or 90 degree, we were going to see from the engineering designs which would be better from a space and from a cost perspective. So that's kind of an overall. So your U-turn, 90 degree, at the Ashworth and Ocean Boulevard was shared. And a lot of comments by commissioners was that it would be difficult to do anything right now from south of that intersection, say from Ocean Walk to the bridge. And the main reason was that the bridge, as you know, might know, is also in the 10-year transportation plan to completely build a new bridge, which would alter the whole traffic flow from coming in from Seabrook all the way into Ocean Walk. So that design of the bridge would alter any of the roadway, any of the paths, any of the ways coming into state parks. So it was the commissioners who felt that we didn't want to make any changes or recommendations of spending money in that area until we saw what DOT was going to do in their planning for the bridge, at which point they would have public hearings and gather information, once again, by the local community on their feelings of, one, a new bridge, and what impact that new bridge would have.
Excuse me, George. So the decision about putting a light at the end of Dustin and Dover and that would not occur in this, it would go with the bridge replacement?
Correct. Eliminating the two lanes north of Ashworth. I have to tell you, you would be in the minority in that, because everybody that we talked to, including public safety, both fire and police, really liked that idea. And so, along with other folks that had commented throughout the all of the public hearings, so that recommendation of keeping it two lanes, but it's really not two lanes, it's three lanes, because there is a middle lane for turning.
Yeah, but the traffic on that middle lane, if it backs up like it backs up now to go through the Shear Street, it'll be all the way to the Ashwood.
Right. Once again, Ed, your comments were heard, but the consensus was to keep it the way it was recommended.
I just think it's unusual for, you know, to have the main exit from the beach of our size to be a driveway, essentially.
Highland Avenue was a we discussed Highland Avenue, and it was decided to keep it as is. Once again, listening to public safety in terms of traffic control. So we didn't make any recommendations about Highland, of changing the traffic flow on Highland. The traffic data was updated on those streets, and I'll make sure you get a copy of that information. There, to my knowledge, was not included in traffic flow into the state park, but I will double check on that. Brown Ave, in terms of the continuation, nobody else brought that discussion up in terms of extending Brown Ave and bringing it down to the marina. So that subject really didn't go anywhere. Same as
wasn't to the marina. Brown Ave was, what I was saying was, Brown Ave originally was scheduled to go somewhere south of where it is now.
Right.
But what I was suggesting is bringing it just over to F Street and having a causeway run along the rail.
We didn't really get any many comments on that. If any, you were the only one who made that comment. And then the same with 107 connector. That nobody brought up that once again. So all I'm saying is that your comments were submitted, your comments were read, and nothing went from there on that.
One other thought on the bridge, John. I asked also if there's been some talk of making that a fixed span instead of a lift. And I believe the first bridge on a navigable waterway has to be a lift bridge unless you get congressional approval. So I asked that if that had been investigated both way back when we did the original master plan and this new town. I don't know whether anybody's investigated.
From what I've been told, DOT right now is in the very preliminary stages of looking at a design of a bridge. It is scheduled for construction of the bridge, if approved, and all of the permits are given and right-of-ways and all that stuff. We're talking about 2024, 2025. But there, the initial designs is looking at both drawbridge and also bridge high enough that boats can go underneath without opening up the bridge.
All I'm suggesting is they need to really should check on that fixed span before you get too far down in the design of that.
Okay. Thank you, Ed.
Thank you.
Under appointments, we have, I guess he carries two titles now, Selectman in Town and also New Hampshire State Representative Phil Bean. I asked Mr. Bean to come to the meeting tonight. There's been some discussion, both in a newspaper and up in Concord, about House Bill 302, and then it recently being somewhat amended to include the Hampton Beach Area Commission. So I felt it would be important for Mr. Bean to come and speak to the commission on House Bill 302, what his intent is, but also to give us an understanding of the legislative process of where his bill goes through, both in the House committees, to the House, the Senate, et cetera, so that we have an understanding. I did, Phil, provide each commissioner with a copy of your bill. And so welcome, and thank you for spending part of your Thursday evening here at the Hampton Beach Commission.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. Good evening. It's good to be back in this room. I'm not here much. for the record, the bill is before Resources, Recreation, and Development. It is Bill 302, and it is exactly what it says. And it's not too dissimilar from what was presented by an organization for the study with the Warren article. There's no requirement for funding for the streets in the poles uptown. And I think the study of land use, the study of business relationships, the study of that remarkable asset that is Hampton Beach, and the remarkable job that you people do as commissioners in managing that relationship is important. It came to committee last week. I spoke on the Dredd director spoke, Phil Bryce spoke there, and it's before a committee. And again, it is simply, and Charlie has spoken about it here in public comment, it is not for that end state, as the Portsmouth Herald opined, that we are going to lease, or you're going to lease, or the Village District is going to lease anything. It is simply a study. And a study much like the study and the data that went into the Sunapee leasing from the state. The state wasn't leasing that or operating that property to its fullest, and Okemo Corporation has taken it over. There's now been an extension of the lease, and if you ski and you get up there, and you skied before when the state owned it, and you ski there now, it's a quantum leap in the experience in terms of both productivity, the use of the asset, and customer satisfaction. This bill would simply, as I have spoken at the committee, your Hampton Beach Area Commission is under 216J, and it's a broad and general enabling act that allows you folks to conduct your business. And under Section 216J3, there's some general indications about land rights and assist the state and town in acquiring lands, and that sounds more of about purchase and land rights, but nothing specifically is in the Okemo execution of a lease and a long-term lease where someone other than the state and someone other than people in Concord are administrating state assets. It didn't work well in Sunapee, and I'm not saying that the state doesn't do a good job. You people have a real good fix on that. The Prestons do, Family Beaches do. Rick is a selectman, of course, and he's been down there for decades. But what a study does do is it sharpens the skills both of the people that are on your commission, the town, and the state. And I will tell you, having testified up at the state, having submitted six pieces of legislation this year, there was a concentric, myopic attitude in the state that I don't feel is responsive enough to local rule, local use, local people. It's very concentric up there. Mr. Bryce did testify that he was not in favor of just the study, and this is exactly how I spoke at the committee in presenting the bill. And following that, of course, Mr. Bryce has a big job. He's the total park system. But committee members came out to me later and said, you know, that's a no-brainer. How can you be not in favor of a study? There's no monetary value associated with this. You have a fund if you choose to do something, but there's no request for money. It's revenue neutral. It's long-term. It doesn't say that it must be done this year, next year, but it orients both the state and most importantly the state and the town to that asset. There's wide sentiment that it's underdeveloped in terms of its year-round utilization. I have run down there every year when I've been in the town and not been otherwise working for the government for decades. And of course, you people live down there and conduct commerce down there. You're the experts. And I think that the lack of the state's amortization of revenue in terms of return on that asset investment down there 12 months a year actually hurts businesses. it actually hurts business and hurts you in developing your clientele and your customer base. And the world has changed in the last 30 years. The seawall is no longer green and metal, it's concrete. The state, I think, and others think, that it's been slow to adjust their operational response, their service response, and their facilities management down there. So this would simply orient the state and engage them. I think it's problematic when, and his other committee members that I testified before said to Mr. Bryce after he presented his written testimony, said, you know, if you don't study these issues, then how do you know what's going on? And how do you know what's the optimal use? And that's exactly the point. And what it does is, while your document 216J is general, this codifies it. It would go under J3, it would be number nine, Roman numeral number nine. And it simply would state to study the feasibility of the town of Hampton in the Hampton Beach Village District lease of State of New Hampshire property in Hampton, New Hampshire. It's innocuous, it's general, it's enabling, and I think it enlightens both the commission, denizens in Hampton, and most importantly, the state. It's you're here for business, you're here to look at additional utilization that is a force multiplier both for tourists, for property owners, for the tax base, for the town of Hampton. And of course, we all know that song and dance, if you will, that we've talked about for years is our, and I did state it in benign terms, but it's hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars a year that we spend with police, fire, and our infrastructure to support the beach. You know, they have the beach there, we've got problems with pipes that are coming off that beach, and their sewage has to go through that. So, you know, we're all in this together, and it's a good relationship. And I think Mr. Bryce's, and I won't speak for him, but I will reiterate his testimony. He's concerned about the revenue of $1 million that goes to the total park system. It's siphoned off, if you will, and transferred up to parks. And that's fine. And perhaps there's room at the end of the tunnel, and light at the end of the tunnel that maybe there's more revenue that could be extrapolated and retained from just that $1 million. If you look at different business platforms at the beach, if you look at different business platforms here in town, there are people, some of them in this room, that have a postage stamp size piece of property compared to what the state has, and they generate exponentially more in terms of satisfying customers, in terms of making a profit, in terms of generating revenue and being good neighbors, and that's year round. So that is the thrust of it. Again, no monetary expenditure, just simply to codify and highlight that option of leasing. And I think it stands up the state to respond. And if Director Bryce, and he's the director, is against the study, if that's not codified in your founding document, then I think it's problematic from cooperation from the state. And having testified on six bills up there this month, there are state employees, and they're very protective about their turf. And naturally so. It's their job, and they're the experts, and that's just the way it is. I know a little bit about my profession. Rick knows about his. Chuck, Mr. Merrill, planners, hospitality people. So I think if we don't codify that, it's very tough to work with a $5 billion business, which is the state, that has other interests throughout the state of New Hampshire. The profit, the $1 million, gets siphoned off. And I've been up there, and I will just say this, that I've been up there as a cross-country skier, and you go to parks that are beautifully sanded in the winter. We don't get beautifully sanded. They're beautifully plowed, and there's nobody at the parks. There's just nobody there. There's no cars. There's nothing. It's a beautiful parking lot. And we don't get that kind of response. Those parks generate $0. They lose money. Actually lose money. You folks are down there at the beach. You're generating tens and tens and tens and millions of dollars of revenue for the state, taking your money, and they're enriching other areas of the state. And I maintain that that can still be done, but there are greater and more significant profit and revenue end states and higher operational levels that can be obtained, and that it will drive business and make it a 12-month destination, not not a shorter 12-week. So that's it. I think it's innocuous. I think it's very supportive of the commission. I think it's very supportive of the town. I think it's very supportive of the village district, and it highlights all of those strengths, and I think it would alert the state to be more cohesive and more cooperative in the long-term planning process. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, commissioners.
Before we leave, Phil, Fran, any comments, questions?
The first thing that comes to mind is money, you know, how we pay for it. We don't have a lot of money. $10,000, roughly.
And again, this is Revel and Newtha, and it doesn't require the study. It says that you can maintain that responsibility and duty, but it is no money.
I mean, for us to find money to do it, you know, right. Not opposed to the study, but paying for it.
So,
thank you.
Phil, just clarify that, because I just want to make sure that everybody understands. You said to have it in our list of these powers and duties doesn't necessarily mean that we have to actually do the study.
It enables you with that power. It codifies it. But you know, you're the chairman. You're the commission. Yeah, we're going to do a study in what year is this? 2021. But it puts it on paper. It orients this, the state. It orients your commission in the town, and it highlights it. It doesn't mandate anything other than it gives you power as commissioners, and I think that's a good thing.
Okay. Any comments?
I hope that you have a lot of luck up there, and I know it's not going to be easy. And I know, from sitting next to you, that no one navigates all of the state systems better than you do. I watch you on your computer, and I have a feeling you know what goes on. You come to some conclusions, and maybe that's what got you to run. So, good luck.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Bob, comments, questions?
What's your sense of the likelihood of the state representatives supporting this, assuming the study comes out in favor of doing it?
You know, that's Charlie talked about, you know, taking care of your own house now. And again, who would know that anyone would support anything until you actually start studying things, Bob? And that's a good question. And again, I think that's Phil Bryce's concern is, you know, this is his baby. It generates $1 million in cash. He funds others. And nobody's trying to take that away. What we're trying to do is actually just study that operation. And I don't think state employees, as a rule, Tracy Emmerich works Ways and Means Finance. They hear testimony, and they hear testimony from a state employee, a director, that the state does not monetize its capital assets. And they're in government. That's not their business. Mr. Rage does that. Mr. Merrill does that. Mr. Griffin does that. Mr. Preston does that. Our town planner, he's a town planner. You know, he's not a moneymaker. He's a town planner. So that I think is the question is we actually get on the beach, no pun intended, and we start, you know, digging up some sand and taking a look at stuff and studying, and then who knows what comes out of that.
Mr. Preston, comments, questions?
Yeah, I was reading this week that there's some legislation that's been filed in the House and Senate for offices like mine that do business in Seabrook to report our in-room and meals taxes for what we collect in Seabrook and for what we collect in Hampton. And this is a piece of information that, you know, we never really had. You know, if we had that piece, I think it might help to go back to Concord to say, well, now we do know what Hampton Beach generates. I think that's a bigger piece of money than state parks would generate. I think that would might help to get a little slice of the room and meals tax, and it wouldn't have to be much, you know, to pay. I think we do have a good relationship with parks, and I think it's been getting better over time since they built that building, and we have a good conduit with Mike, you know, going up to Concord. So I really would not want to disrupt that very, very much. I would want to go back to, well, I call it Senator Stiles' bills to try to get money from a different way. And this, your story up there may highlight, you know, exactly what, you know, Hampton contributes in police and fire and trash. So I don't think it can hurt. But I don't know that that's the way we're going to get much money out of it.
If that's your question, this is not about getting money, and I'm glad you support the rooms and meals bill, because it's my bill, And I've testified before Ways and Means, and the first time you go in there, it's who's this new old guy, and then after the third time, but you know, because they discourage you from putting in legislation. And I informed the chairman that I read the memo, but I didn't follow it, and it got some it got some laughs. But it is, you raise a good point, Bob, is that there were several pieces, and Randy Cushing really turned Concord upside down last week when he got his 413, which is that the state is going to start the bill. It's about a $40 million kickback to local governments. Came out of committee 10-9, and it has the governor's attention. It has the entire body's attention, and that comes back to fund the pension that the state took away. And our legislation, the legislation that I have drafted and submitted, that Rainey's done, that other members of the delegation, speaks to exactly what you're saying. And you can feel it in Concord, you can feel it with the legislative body, that it is more locally power-driven, and that the state is not master that must be served, because the money comes from here. And those are our police down there, and those are our firemen, and those are our pension costs. And the state simply, years ago, and you speak to that in revenue, they just said, we're not going to do it anymore. They induced the towns to join the pension system, and then under Governor Lynch, they just said, you know, we're not going to pay any money. And two-thirds of our pension costs right now that come out of everyone's tax dollar go to fund the deficit from the state walking away. So there's that kind of power up there that I think everyone is turning over. And I will tell you that leadership up there on myriad issues thinks they can dictate down to the representatives of the people. And those days are over. You can feel it in the room. Whether the speaker says something, the minority leader or the governor, it's like nobody's buying that stuff anymore. They're just not buying it. And they can feel it up there. And you can see leadership on their heels. So you raise a good point. And that tide is turning. And it's about time Hampton started getting a little bit more recognition. Because they don't make any money in the state. And they're not doing a heck of a lot down here.
Just for the record, two things. One is that when I knew Representative Bean was coming here today, sent you all a copy of his House bill. But I also received an email from Phil Bryce that had his testimony attached so that you could also read that. I also believe Mike will indicate that Phil has requested to come to our next meeting, which will be on the 23rd of February.
I think so, yes.
To said he'd come speak down sometime. Also to the commission, and that will come in as an appointment. So, Mike, do you have any comments?
No, other no than comments, that? No.
Okay. Dean?
Just a short thing, Bill. So you testified in front of the committee.
Yes, sir.
Did they vote on it?
It's in committee. They call it the exec. It's due out in March, so they're going to kick the tires. There was a response from the chair to me today. I responded on some of his information requirements about funding, which it not is. And again, this is innocuous. This isn't trying to take power away from the state. This is a better relationship. This is codifying options. This is a good business practice. And it's not about getting money out of the parks for the town. This is about looking at that whole operation, and the state, quite frankly, isn't really capable of doing that on its own. They've got a lot.
So the committee is information searching before they.
Yes, they are, sir. Yeah. And I will tell you from members, there is the sentiment. It's like it's a no brainer. Who doesn't want to do a study on this? This is valuable.
Okay. Chip,
I gotta thank you and all the reps from Hampton. We're a small town, and we have big voices there, and I think you're doing a great job.
Thank
as
you,
well
Mr.
as the other reps. And we're a small town, but we have a budget of a city. We do the job of a city. In the summer months, we create enormous revenue for the state. So it's great that you're out there and you're fighting for Hampton. And if you keep this up, I could see a speaker position opening up for you, maybe. So, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rage. Appreciate it.
Okay, Phil. I just have one question at this point, and let's make an assumption for a minute. Let's just say, hypothetically, that this bill passes, and let's just say that this commission, by majority, votes to go ahead with the study. And in that study, it says that it's feasible. But for the town to lease State Park?
From State Parks, that it would be X dollars, X million dollars to be able to do that based on what State Parks' expenses are today, including bonding requirements, etc. So let's just say to make State Parks say, yeah, this would work for us, we would need X amount of dollars to make this happen from our end so that we don't walk away from that lease losing money. Would it be your intention to look at it from that perspective to say, and let's hypothetically say, and I'm going to throw out a number, it's probably not even close, but let's just say that the revenue that the State Parks takes in but then pays out with regard to bonding and everything, it would be $3 million under a lease for them to say, yep, we'll lease it to the town of Hampton, but we need $3 million to cover our expenses and cost. Would you then think that it would be up to the town to say whether or not it's valued at $3 million from a lease perspective and for that to go forward?
Yeah, and I think that's a good question, but I think it's the cart before the horse, and I think it's what Charlie addressed when he came up and spoke at public comment. And I study, Rick says, he sees me on the computer during the meeting, I study the state financials. I probably know them a little bit less better than, a lot less better than Phil, Mr. Hausman, but I do study them, and it's a cash cow for the state and funds the entire park system. There's two or three parks that make money, and we're one of them. So it's before the horse, and as Rick knows, and as some of you know, how I lead and serve the people is I use the finance director for information and ask questions, and they provide the data. The town attorney, the town manager. What I don't see is this is a money making issue. I don't see it. Mr. Preston is you know, it's a money making issue. I see it as sharpening the sword in one of the most valuable pieces of real estate in New England, and the state owns it. And the state runs it for 12 weeks, and they shut the door on it. And I think there's room for improvement on that. When I speak to what this does in sharpening the sword, and study items could be from something that on my way to Concord this morning, I stopped off and saw the town manager and said I would have the privilege to come and speak with you people tonight. I said, can you run up some things that you think might be worthy of further study? And I'm not saying these aren't being done now, but Fred listed off 15, and I'll give you an example that a study could do. And it doesn't have to cost a lot of money for a study. It doesn't have to cost any money. A lot of real sharp people here. We have a town planner. We've got some people. But improve parking fees programs. Effectively utilize the state park south at the river. Improve maintenance of facilities. Establish year-round utilization of and maintenance of parking areas. Establish year-round maintenance of sidewalks for walkers. Establish a year-round aggressive rental program for meeting and social events. Provide for a placement and maintenance program with depreciating funding. Establish aggressive recycling program for beach users. Establish an aggressive clean beach program for elimination of trash on the beach. Provide for effective full-time policing of the beach by Hampton Police Department. Provide a fire ambulance police summer substation area to assist the beach users. We're picking up most of those capital and operating costs now. The state pays nothing. Establish a 10-year program for all activities for uses and users. Establish 10-year programs for budgets, capital items, depreciation reserves. Establish snow and ice removal and storage plans. Establish community and regional activity programs for year-round uses of facilities. Now, Mr. Hausman and Mr. Bryce are going to say they're doing a lot of that, and I would agree with that. But it sharpens the sword, and when you have more partners, especially as I look around this board here and the imminent caliber and capabilities of people sitting before me, who wouldn't want to have them assist in the study? So to the end state about numbers, I like to read financials. I like to read income statements. But that cart is way before the horse, and this is simply the ground. And, you know, you guys in the state, there's a lot of things going on. May not get to it for a couple of years. But I think it's important to get on the beach, again, no pun intended, and empower and enable the legislation to give you people more power and to tighten the relationship with the state, as Mr. Preston asserts, and get better and get a better product. Because we all know whether it's our own business, our own personal lives, our professional lives, governing bodies, is we're all trying to seek perfection. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate it.
Next on the agenda is we have both Chris Jacobs and Jennifer Hale from the Hampton Public Works, who I asked once again to come and speak on a couple of beach-related warrant articles, which I think is important for the commission to, at minimum, listen to and hear and possibly even come out and support. Welcome, Jennifer. Welcome, Chris.
Welcome.
Sorry we had to pull you out on a evening meeting.
No. We're used to it. It's the season.
It is the season for meetings. It's the season. Take one passing around.
So did you want to get a rundown on all the warrant articles we proposed, or are you more interested in...
The ones that have direct impact on the beach.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So there's a wall, the sewer force main.
Yep. Are the two biggies.
Are the two biggies.
Jennifer's put together all the slide presentations, and by the way, some of our information is up on the town's website, basically on the public works section. The force main situation, for lack of a more softer word, was presented 2 weeks ago when we were down in Boston at the New England Water and Federation meeting. It was presented to a group of professionals that, you know, other public works directors, engineers. We thought that they'd be impressed, if you will, by, well, that it cost $120,000 to march out in the marsh and cost less than $10,000 to make the repair. And they weren't. They were impressed that we found it in February and repaired it in March, because there were other public works departments and dealing with their governments and their processes and states that 6 months, 8 months, 10 months. So it was interesting to see that that was their perspective. So they congratulated us on finding it and then finding a solution and then being able to, with the selectmen's help, implement that solution. So that was... It was a different response than what I thought we were going to get, but it also shows how other people are also dealing with the same types of issues or similar issues. One other public works director came up to us and he had the same situation, a broken force main, but his was in the dry. It was adjacent to a road, somewhat cross country, but in the same vein. Only had about a... took them a week to pull a contractor out of the woods and get it done. But he didn't have to deal with the Wetlands Bureau. He didn't have to deal with an emergency wetlands permit. He didn't really have a discharge of effluent into a prime wetland. So it was a different ball of wax. But even he was impressed at how quickly we were able to pull it together. So I'll turn it to Jennifer. She's got a bunch of the slides, and you've all got the copies in front of you. And for the people at home, again, these are the same slides that are up on the
will town. Be up on the town website, right, after a deliberative session,
right,
on Saturday.
But some of these are some of the same,
yes,
slides that were used in Boston, so the same information is up there. So take it away.
All right. The reason I want to put the pictures in front of you, because it'll help walk through it. The idea is basically to make sure there's a complete understanding of what it is we're asking for and why we're asking for it. The first slide that you're looking at is really an aerial to show that the Church Street pump station on Church Street handles all the sewer flow from Hampton Beach, as well as the Sun Valley section across the bridge on the other side. It's all that flow, that sewer and winter, comes to the treatment plant and is treated, and the flow varies. You can see here in this slide, you know, for what you may see in an average, you know, winter day of, you know, 0.3, 0.4. In a summer, that 0.7 is an average, but we've had over a million. So when this all came to light, it was about, what, this time, this day, last year.
A year ago today.
Happy anniversary, everyone. It was February, so it was winter flows. It was low flows. The timeline really started back in December when NHDES had notified us that they were getting some high fecal counts. They really weren't sure where it was coming from. We worked with them to sort of just pinpoint, okay, where could high fecal counts come from? It wasn't the outlet of our treatment plant. The outlet of our treatment plant is this same Tide Creek area, but all our tests at the outlet were fine. They were all within our normal ranges. So we worked with them again in January. We sat down. We agreed to do more testing. We were going to do some testing. They were going to do some testing. It was late January, February. We got some very, very, very high hits at that bridge, the 101 West Bridge into the beach at Tide Mill Creek. That flow leaves, if you're looking at that first page, you know, the yellow arrows that are showing you, it doesn't go out to the ocean. It comes back in and around. So the water had to come under that bridge, which meant the contaminated was on what you'd want to call the east side of the bridge. So went out there, went out walking. So if you go to the second page of slides, you'll see a picture of what we saw. This was a depressed area. It was gray. It was green. I'm sparing you the blown up version of corn and some other things. But that was it. That's how, between the visual observation and the fact that the Church Street pump station, it doesn't run continuously. It turns on, turns off, turns on, it turns off, doing its cycles. So while they were out there, it turned on and the water bubbled and it came back down. So at that point it was on the phone, we have a problem, it was shut off. From there, we started meeting with the selectmen, I think probably every Monday. We became a regular. Went in, we tried to present, you know, what we had found, what we could and couldn't do, and it became a whole process for us. It wasn't just, okay, well, let's think about it, let's get to it. I mean, it was February, it was low flows, but we had one line active. The one line active was, well, this year it's 50 years old. Am I right? I'm doing my math wrong. I got my dates all messed up. But it's the old asbestos concrete line.
67.
It's 50 years old this year. And so our concern was, okay, you know, what do we do now? We have to get something online. We talked to barge companies, very helpful company out of Pepperell Cove over the bridge in Maine. Wanted to see if we could go that route because it would be shorter, but we were fighting the drafts and getting under the bridge at Tide Mill Creek. We were fortunate enough that a wetland consultant said, hey, have you ever heard of this Maybe Nats company? We hadn't. Gave them a call. They sent a guy up from Florida to come see what we were talking about. They had some sites out of Pennsylvania that they were distributing out of. We were able to basically go, okay, we could do this, Matt. We didn't even know if we could. So weighed out all the options, tried to figure out, okay, what else do we need? Well, if you're looking on that second slide, you'll see two little white boxes on the marsh route. We had two Tide Creek crossings, two tidal crossings. So we needed two bridges in addition to all those mats. No less a permit from NHDES because we're going to be working in a prime wetland, traveling over it, and needing to do some excavation. All of this, again, it was the light bulb. You know, it goes off, okay, wait. What's our emergency plan to the emergency plan? What if something goes wrong with the concrete pipe while we're out there trying to fix the ductile iron pipe? Then what do we do? Because the whole area then doesn't have a way to get to the wastewater treatment plant. So from there, we pretty much, you know, worked through a temporary emergency plan, which would involve laying piping along 101 in an emergency type situation. Worked with some contractors to get some timing and some pricing. You know, telling us that it's going to take 11 days and, you know, $100,000 plus and $13,000 a week after that. So we had an emergency plan, but our plan was to repair the pipe. So if you're looking at your next slide, I believe, of course, I handed out all mine. Okay. So I don't recall which ones I've given you.
Thank you.
There you go. So the next slide is really, once we laid all the mats in that first top picture, you'll see that there's a very large excavator, and it's sitting on those mats. Those mats went from the edge of Church Street Pump Station, 1,300 feet out, up and over the bridges, And we walked that, a dump truck, a septic hauler, us, a box truck, you name it, went up and down these mats trying to get to the area where we saw the leak. That top picture is the leak we saw, the water in the hole. We set up over it. We tested. We were very, very fortunate. On the fourth day, 3 days to lay the mats, the first day we dug, we did find the pipe. And again, on that picture that you're, or page you're looking at, the pipe we found is what you're seeing on the bottom there. It's a pipe with a hole in it. And that hole, just to orientate you, was face down. And those rocks in the picture next to it were right next to it. So we had a hole in the pipe. That was the leak. So we made the decision right then and there, let's get it fixed. We were certainly prepared. We had ordered pipe ahead of time. The contractor was there. We made the repair that day. We closed up the hole and we walked ourselves off the marsh. It was a very stressful month. still sounds like we did it in 4 days, but it was a month of planning. But we got off, but we still had to figure out, okay, now what do we do from here? So from there, you know, we still worked with our consultants and tried to figure out, okay, what's the next steps? Yeah, we had rocks in a hole, and, you know, that just isn't right. It created one. Could there be other rocks? Can we find other rocks? But wait. What is really going to happen here if this happens again? It's sort of brought it to attention. That concrete line is 50 years old. It's laying in a salt marsh. We have a younger line that's failed. We've now realized that if this had happened in the summer, we would have been in a different scenario than we were in February. It's just the differences in the flow. How do we maintain this in the future? You know, how do we make sure there isn't going to be a problem? So we went through a matrix, and I know you can't read all this small stuff, but it was really to show you the thought and the process that went through it. What can we do? Go for it.
The point that she just made, and then that is, how do we maintain it? One of the major issues and why we're in this situation is 87, what, 30 years ago, we elected to put this pipe in the ground, or the steel one. 1967, so 50 years ago, we elected to put in the AC pipe. By the way, those pipes, the AC pipe actually replaced another pipe that had previously been laid in the marsh. Because it was, the thought at the time was, path of least resistance, shortest route, and we didn't really have the wetlands rules that we have today. The problem with having the force mains in the marsh, there's no reasonable way to get there to clean them. Every other sewer line in town, we have the town blessed us with. We have a vacuum truck that we use to jet out these the sewer lines, all the sewer lines in town. And we even have a camera truck where it looks like a torpedo on wheels. We literally send it down the lines after we clean them to inspect them to make sure that there's no breaks, no major leaks, the connections are solid, this thing's got a movable eye on it, can see all that. We can't do that with either pipe in the marsh. They're 4,000 feet long. To get into them, to actually inspect them, we'd have to break into them. To break into them, we'd have to be out in the marsh. We'd need a wetlands permit to do that. We'd more than likely get asked many, many times over by the Wetlands Bureau, you're going to have to find some other way to do this if you want to keep doing it on a regular basis. So those lines have never been cleaned. They've never been video inspected. Why? Because they're laying in the middle of the marsh. Another problem that we have is that most of my sewer lines are laid to a grade, to a pitch. This sewer line is 8 feet under the most of the marsh. Dips under one creek, runs at 8 feet, dips under another creek, has five major dips in it. So the pipe actually has elbows in it, up and down. And when we talked with the video inspection, talked with the people to clean the pipe before they could video inspect it, they said you'd have to break it at every one of those major joints, the creek connections. They looked at for four major breaks. So before, when I said you took $120,000 worth of money to get out to the first location to technically dig it up and break the pipe. To just to clean it and video inspect would take four times that. And then just then, it's the cost of videotape and inspect after that. And they all were very reluctant because of the inaccessibility. They said, you're going to have to sign a waiver that if we lose our equipment, it gets stuck in there, the cable breaks, or we lose the plug that we use to clean it, you're going to own it. Oh, okay. So that's what we were up to, and this is what we were trying to figure out right after we had fixed it. How do we clean it, inspect it, and move on? Back to Jeff.
And that is, in reality, the first column on this matrix that we put together. And that's what I was getting at, was that this matrix was put together on a whole bunch of what do we do if-then scenarios. And the first was, well, let's see. What can we see from the inside? On the AC pipe, the Festus concrete one, you could, in the real world, you could put the camera in it. Well, to put the cameras in them, you have to clean them. So it goes back exactly to what Chris was saying. You know, these pipes are not laid just flat. We'd have to get out there, break them to get them cleaned to put the cameras in them. People have asked us, why didn't you use ultrasonic on the ductile iron? You know, you could have gotten the thickness all the way across, known if you had any issues. Again, to put this type of equipment in there, we would have needed to clean it, which would have involved breaking it and all the waivers for this expensive equipment to go in it. So that was sort of the continued investigation approach and where would it get us. Other options, only because, well, if they put the first two lines in the march, someone's always going to ask, well, why not keep it in there? Well, the maintenance and access are obviously the number one, right along the environmental sensitivity points of it all. You know, you can't get to it. We can't maintain it. We can't clean it. Why would we put it back in there to have this same problem again, or risk the potential of failure directly in the prime wetland area? But there were options. You know, people said you can slip line the pipes, you can do what they call pipe bursting. So we looked at those options as well. What would it get us? Would we be able to get increased capacity? If we're going to do all this, we better plan for the future as well. So we looked at some in marsh replacement. We looked at directional drilling. That's where you take sort of basically a solid fused pipe, put it in, get rid of these joints and elbows that are in the current construction, and do that. And then you look at the cost of that for, again, two lines. We need two lines and upsizing them. And it was approaching, you know, the $4.2 million, and we've done nothing to address the ability to maintain and access these lines. We've just put them right back in the same spot for somebody in the future to deal with. So the next route that we looked into was, well, what happens if we do a Route 101 replacement? What will that get us? So that was sort of the whole matrix of options that we presented. And we came through and we said, all right, well, what are the consequences of the force main failure? What happens? I mean, it's just a what happens scenario if this force main fails. It was said at one of the selectmen meetings that, you know, we are a five-star beach. I did a little research, wanted to figure out where all that came from, and you know, it's right here. Hampton Beach is one of 13 superstar beaches in the United States. It's one of the safest in the nation to swim at because of its cleanliness of the water. That's something that's been earned, and the beach has been developed over time. When you look at that, what would happen if we had a failure? That emergency plan that was our backup to the backup plan when we were doing the fix would have to be implemented. The numbers on that turn out to be $100,000 for the first month, $13,000 a week thereafter. And that would be temporary. So while you do that, you'd have to be doing something else. We experienced it this time around. There were restrictions. As you recall, a year ago, Penguin Plunge again, Friday, we did a lot of just making sure the water was safe, a lot of testing, making sure people could still swim. Shellfish was shut down. We received many, many emails on when is it going to open, when is it going to open. But we lost, I think, a good part of that season.
Pretty much the whole season.
All of this has to do with losing revenue for local people. There's also a loss of revenue that can happen across the beach, so that's statewide, local-wide. It did happen off season. The implications compound on season. And it's not a straight line. It's exponentially just for the amount of flow that comes over from the beach during the summertime versus what comes in the winter. And the amount of people that are over there, businesses that are open, and what's affected. And I put the last one on this slide because I think it really ties back up to what happened in the beginning. There's reputation recovery. It's nothing I can quantify, but I really think it's a real statement. If there's a failure again and something does happen, what does that say if our beach isn't our beach? And it's a statement. That's what it's meant to be. So we did move forward and received approval to go ahead with the design of the new force main out of the marsh. And when we say out of the marsh, it's along 101. It follows, and yes, there is a bridge. We are building a utility bridge. We are not putting it back under the creek. We're not putting it back in the marsh. We're moving alongside to Tide Mill Road and then Tide Mill Road to the plant. So it will be accessible. There are ports built into it. There's redundancy built into the design so that we can take a pipe offline and have the capacity in the other line. The beach has grown since these lines have been put in. The engineers have looked at what has been that growth rate and done future growth into this as well. Again, if we're doing the project, we're doing it good and well for the long haul. So that is the plan, and that is the one item, Article 10 on the warrant.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
We've been mandated by the state to do this. Is that correct?
We recently received an administrative order from the state.
So if this fails, it still has to be done. Is that right?
Eventually. Or we go back to the table with them and say, okay, this is the results of the vote. We didn't get the funding. What can we do?
They work with you. We've been through right. this position before.
It would, you know, I'm sure Fred, town's attorney, Jennifer and I, our engineers, with 10 of their people, would all sit in the same room and figure out what to do. Short term and long term. But do I, if your question was specific, does it have to be done someday? Yes.
Well, no, I'm hoping that the mandate would just do it anyways. I mean,
but it's based upon the funding.
Right.
You know, we looked at with the other options, you know, could we pipe burst the steel one, put in a larger pipe? That cost was equal to the same to laying this new one on along 101. We looked at horizontally boring, abandoning the two that are there now and just. They may have technology now where you can horizontally bore and then literally pull through or push through a continuous poly pipe. Again, $4 million. The only reason why we didn't go with either one of those, we're still in the marsh. We still have no access. We still have a costly, almost, I mean, it's, The cost to clean and inspect these lines, $500,000. So do I really want to do that every other year for $500,000 under the marsh? It just seemed to be a...
Seemed like a circle that we kept going in.
Exactly.
It didn't get out of it at all.
Right.
It didn't, you know, when you look at a project like this, you look at the objectives. You know, what is it that we're trying to do? Something happened and it made it come to light. It said, okay, light bulb on. We have a problem. It was a problem that needed to be solved right then and there, but what were its effects and where do we go from here? So,
And we don't currently have pressure testing or any type of testing on our current force mains, but in the last couple of discussions, state, they said, you've enlightened us because you've had this break. We're going to ask everybody in the future to pressure test, to clean, and to video inspect or some other way inspect for the integrity of their lines, especially when they're in sensitive environments like a prime wetland. And we're not the only community. New Market's got a sewer line under a pond. We hear from a bunch of other communities that have sewer lines in very tenuous locations. And the future is going to be, you have to maintain. And because one of the things that says in the AO is we have a responsibility to mitigate any future potential discharges, meaning be responsible, do the right thing, protect the environment. And that's what they're holding us to.
Dean, any questions? Mike?
No.
Bob?
Yeah, I just had a couple. One, as a board, you know, I think we should strongly support the voters coming out, you know, in favor of this. I don't know that it will ever be cheaper if you fix it now or 5 years from now. Now that we know that there's been a problem, I think we can get in trouble with penalties from, you know, wherever they come from. I don't know. They come from the state or the federal government. And as one of the businessmen in town talks about the two miracle miles, I mean, we have to keep them. You know, we have to maintain Route 1, and we have to maintain Hampton Beach. So I think it's important for us to support this, and I hope the voters will go ahead and do it as well.
Mr. Mann?
I think it's a critical project. I agree with we should support it.
Mr. Griffin?
You know, I think they've done a wonderful job right from the very beginning, and a lot of work has gone into this. And part of how I feel about it is I just hated to see people rush into it. And they do seem to have done a great job, though. And I know from working with the state before, they do work with it. If people vote this down, it's not the end of the world. They will work with them, and they'll try to make it better in the future, and we would try to make it better in the future, too. And I do agree with Bob. It probably will never be any cheaper than it is today. But there's just a part of me, and I probably am going to be supportive of this, too, that wonders if we didn't invite the state to send the letter. I just can't help but feel that way. Bob?
I just see this as you really don't have any option but to do it. The school last year missed by a couple of percentage points, so this year it's an additional $1 million to redo the academy. Further, where we've had the pipe break already, I don't see the state as being totally benign going forward. I could see them requiring certain expensive things of the town, such as pre-build the emergency pipeline, where it's failed before, you haven't fixed it, and you might have to spend a considerable amount of money for something that, again, doesn't solve the problem. I just don't see any delay as being beneficial.
Assuming there is a positive vote to support this, what is the timeline of it being fixed?
The plans are already at the Department of Environmental Services being reviewed. We're currently working on the master contract or specifications that goes along with that plan. Jennifer and Christina were actually still working on it today. It's already been before the New Hampshire Wetlands Bureau. We requested from the commissioner an expedited review of it, meaning don't take 60 or 90 days as their rules allow. They granted the expedited review. Our engineers don't work in the blind. They met with the Wetlands Bureau ahead of time and said, this is what we're proposing. And they felt the same way that majority of people feel is, you're in a tough situation. This is the best path that we can take. Certainly the Wetlands Bureau prefers something in the dry rather than working in the wet. The hardest part was getting in touch with the Department of Transportation to determine whether we could hang these pipes off of their bridge or not. Basically what they said is, here's the wing wall, why don't you just put up two trusses, put the pipes right between the two trusses, wrap them in insulation. So what you'll see in the future is a little, I call it a 4-foot wide bridge, it's probably a little wider than four. on the two sides. It won't be something that people can walk on. We're going to put a fence up on either end. It gets back to liability and trust and a few other things. So we're working diligently to move the project forward. The game plan is, if the specifications can be made ready, that we'd pre-advertise this, if you will. They're going to call up contractors and say, will you build? Especially the people that have the wherewithal to handle a project of this size. And we were hoping, and the schedule's been discussed with the engineers, that the week prior to the deliberative, the actual town vote on the 14th, we may have a price where we can announce, okay, we've bid it, and the price is X. I have full confidence of the estimate that the engineers have put together, because this is the same engineering group that did the Church Street pump station. If you remember, originally we were told to ask for $4 million some odd dollars, and it came in at 2.4, 2.5. So they put together estimates that I don't believe we're going to blow. In other words, we're not going to miss it. I also agree with the assertion that if it does get postponed, each year it gets postponed, any potential savings we may have had will go out the window. Realize that what we're going to lay in the trench is two 16-inch pipes. It's high-density polyethylene. They actually fuse the joints together mechanically or with heat, so it's a continuous pipe. Its major ingredient is oil. It's made from pelletized plastics. And I know it's a fluctuating market, and that's one of those things that people can control or fluctuate, and that's one of the major ingredients. The only other ingredient, if you will, is drilling and blasting and digging. But that's just time and money. So, you're right. I don't think there's a better time to do it. And I think it's a logical path to take, not only to resolve our present situation, but to ensure the town's growth, sustainability, reliability.
Through the commissioners, I plan to be
Mr.
at
Griffin
the...
Had.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I just wanted to say, and definitely, because I've watched these presentations over and over and over again, you've really got the presentation the way it should be now, from what I've seen. And I think it's much more convincing. At the beginning, there was, there's going to be sewer coming up in the streets of the at the beach and this and that. And to me, that was kind of like... almost like giving out threats that we really don't need. And I think now it sounds like it should sound, and it's
Thank
very
you.
Convincing.
Thank you. We elected to stick with the facts.
Good.
We heard you.
I plan to attend the session on Saturday, so if it's the pleasure of the commission to make a motion one way or the other, I'd be more than happy to present it at the session. Mr. Preston, do you have a motion?
I would make that motion that we highly support this. I think it's very, very important for the whole community, not just the beach.
I have a second. Mr. Rage, second. Any further discussion? All in favor? Aye. Opposed? Okay. Article 24.
Yes, this is the second project that directly affects the beach area, and it's the bicentennial seawall design. Last 45 days, we've been handed this one. This one kind of cropped up. Jennifer put together the slide, so I'll let you discuss the slide.
This actually started some time ago, i.e. last March, when the voters approved to do an investigative study. We visually observed that there was deterioration of the wall, and the pieces were falling, rebar was getting exposed. Something was going on. It was time to find out what that something was. So we went through the process, put it out to select a qualified engineer that could do this study for us. We selected one, And when the engineer did all their work, they did some survey, they did some concrete testing and coring of the walls. They did subsurface testing to see where they could find ledge, where they could find or what materials they were finding under there. We sort of got the, I don't know if you want to call it the bat phone call that, hey, after looking at all this test data, you do know that the wall is not connected to any bedrock. And right now it's got the concrete, they call it the silica reaction, the alkali-silica reaction, silica-alkali reaction, something of that sort. Where the concrete interior, it's actually two walls. It was originally one wall, and they came in and built another wall on top of it. It's crumbling from within. So all the models that they ran with the wave studies and the weather and things like that, there was the potential for failure. So we did receive approval over the last, it was the end of December. We got contractors right in there to do a revetment stabilization. So they brought in 16 feet wide, 5 and 8 ton stones, and put them out like you've seen across the rest of the beach. I do want to say this, and I'm probably going to say it 3 or 4 times before I'm done. That is a temporary repair. As pretty as it looks, it is meant to curtail the fact that if a wave had hit it, it could have been undermined. It doesn't stop the concrete from the interior from breaking down. It doesn't stop the fact that the wall existing is lower than the state wall. So we still have overtopping that's happening that's causing erosion of the beach behind it, as well as water. There's always this nice little trail that runs along the parking lot that heads down to 1A. So this article is now for the next step. It's for the design of a new seawall, a seawall that is needed. Without the seawall, those waves would come up and over that Bicentennial Park area, and Route 1A would be flooded. The new wall has the objectives like we talked about before. It's meant to be as high as the state wall. It's meant to prevent and deter that overtopping. That revetment that we put in, all that stone, that is not wasted. It will be there in the final as well. It will protect the new wall and help dissipate the wave energy. The intent is to stop the erosion on the backside, to work with where the boats can go in now down the dock area and stabilize that. There is a DOT outfall, a drainage outfall from Route 1A that is also has broken apart. So there's a lot of things that aren't right going on. This is the design to get that wall back up and corrected.
So the point would be that we do the design, and part of the reason why we defaulted to just doing the design this year is it was a 9-month approval process for not only New Hampshire Wetlands Bureau, but Coastal Program, U.S. Army Corps, a number of people other than just the Wetlands Bureau. So it didn't make sense to burden the voters this year with the full cost of wall replacement when there was no physical way to actually construct it in 17 anyhow. That was, thankfully, that's something we worked out at the Board of Soldiers that came out through the process of vetting this particular warrant article. The middle photo, I do want to call people's attention on that one particular sheet. In the right in the middle of the photo, and somebody drew a red line, that's actually the bottom of the wall. And the reason why I say within the last 45 days it became very apparent was we had a couple of early storms where once they informed us that this wall just sits on beach sand, we realized that what we were looking at was the bottom of the wall. And that the broken concrete that you see in front of it is more than likely a previous wall, i.e. part of what the Coast Guard had in its location. And, you know, early on, we've seen the photos. The Coast Guard had cedar posts, then they had cedar posts with rocks, then they had cedar posts, rocks, and some concrete. And then it just kept getting a little beefier every time. And that is more than likely part of their wall because you can actually see the rebar in it. And it's those are actual wall sections that fell forward once they finished decaying into the beach area. And in the past, those have always been buried by sand. but we literally lost 4 feet of sand in one or two storms late November, early December, which precipitated the emergency expenditure for the revetment stone, or we'd lose the whole thing.
Excuse me, could I just ask? Now, I don't know this, but I've been listening to people around the beach area where I'm at down there at Boar's Head. I've heard so many people that have lived there for many, many years. They say that in my area, closer to my end, there's never been so much sand. So has that sand gone from that end to the other end?
It's a good question, and it probably in some respects is. We're now noticing on the south end, Hampton Beach, Sun Valley, we've lost a significant amount of beach down there. The aerial photos that we've managed to pull together show that a good portion of that beach is in the harbor, where it wasn't 10 years ago. And so is that sand continually moving up the beach? Yes, I believe it is. But I don't know that. I'm not up. Yeah. I have to admit, this is where I'm not up.
Well, the people are all thrilled because it's almost like there's a beach there.
They must have
right. Yeah.
For a week.
Yeah.
Right. Any other comments by commissioners?
Yeah, just forgive my ignorance, but why is this your wall and not Michael's wall?
Because literally, when we acquired the Coast Guard station from the Coast Guard, the town accepted it, I want to say 59, in about 62. 59, that's when I was born. 62, we burned it down, the old Coast Guard station. That's always been that section of beach north, all the way up around through Place Cove, Billy Joe Brown Park, right up the Northampton town line is ours. It is definitely a line of demarcation.
Hearing no other comments, I think, once again, this would be an important article for the Beach Commission to either support or not support, so I will entertain a motion either way.
I'm not supporting it.
Motion made by Mr. McMahon to support Article 24.
I'll second
Second
that.
By Mr. Griffin. Any further discussion?
I just want to say that, we really did look at it. At first, there was a thought about trying to do it all at once and where there's so many other things, so I think they've done a nice job coming up with this plan. Making a plan.
Okay, further comments? All in favor of the article? Opposed? Jennifer, Chris, thank you very much for taking time tonight to do this, and good luck on Saturday.
Thank you.
Chris was hired with the idea that he had so much knowledge about the underneath the ground, the sewer and all, and I guess it's paid off.
My only experience at the beach was playing in the sand and didn't prepare me for the seawall.
You're going to have a flashback.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you again.
Thanks.
Next on the appointment list, Mr. Charlie Preston wants to talk a little bit about beach traffic flow. Welcome back, Mr. Preston.
Thank you, sir. I checked my text because I think you opened up public comment with what you had me on there. My text said to talk about the actual parking lot.
Go ahead, you under an appointment, didn't I?
Yeah.
I'm going to walk this one.
We've got a nice map now, Chuck. Good evening. I wrote this down, so I always try to make it quick. If I could have one quick community announcement, if you're registering your car in February, consider the state parks plate. $85, you're going to get 83 days of free parking at the beach. Great deal to support local business. You have to do it when you register your car, so it would be great if we could make it a regular announcement. Till the summer. I'm here to ask for something that doesn't cost money. It is common sense. My reason for this appointment is simple, to ask your support, preferably by a motion, to support and recommend to selectmen the exit of the town Ashworth Ave parking lot. You made an exit only during the parking lot season. Doing so would help alleviate traffic on Ashworth Ave, G Street, and Ocean Boulevard for vehicles going north. Costs would be minimal. Examples of past actions which proved effective are the M Street Summit. I don't know if many of you knew about it, but I believe it was held on Dick Bergeron's porch, who was a great guy, common sense guy that lived on top of M Street. And they got together with some local officials, public safety, whatever, and they made the down streets. And they stopped cruising. There wasn't a big study. There wasn't a lot of money spent. They did it. It worked. Another one was the four-way stop on Brown Ave and 101. That was another great move. I don't know how many people all remember that. When it first happened, we were like, well, this, we didn't like change. But if you lived on Ashworth Ave, that four-way stop at 101 and Brown Ave, it works.
I got pulled over the first day.
It worked. I might have been the one that got away. I'm not sure. That day. But they both only cost in signage and not in studies. As we all know, since the invention of the car, people have been known to cruise the strip. Today we are trying to change that, parking and transportation studies. As it now stands, if you exit this lot and want to go north, you have to cruise the strip. Ladies and gentlemen have enjoyed cruising the strip for the scenery, the ocean, of course. But as we get older and hopefully wiser, given the choice of going 1 mile with 13 crosswalks, which are also probably the busiest 13 crosswalks in the town of Hampton, or heading down Brown Avenue where you cross 2 crosswalks and it's only half the distance, and these crosswalks aren't used barely. I like to think most of us would choose the latter. This exit would be incrementally used, meaning a car would go out, could be 5 minutes, 15, half hour, you don't know. But it could also be used for mass evacuation if the chief decided he'd want, if there was an accident on the bridge or Ashworth, he could close that Ashworth Ave gate and send everybody out. But when I gave you this map, you'll see the yellow highlighted. Okay, there's an 18-foot gate there. There was some concern with the parking lot supervisor about cars turning into this lot. When I highlighted that, that is meant to be jersey barriers, which would choke down the opening from 18 to about 13 foot 6, 14 foot. Would, you know, to stop the concern of the parking lot supervisor. Okay. Let's get this done for both our residents and our visiting guests. And I think this is, you know, it's a real simple thing. It doesn't cost us any money, and I think it would work. You know, I think people getting concerned about people turning in there is really a non-issue. And if we want to support it, get it going. I mean, obviously, if it doesn't work, you close the gate again. If it does work, it's a win-win for everybody. And I'm a firm believer that this will work. You got a police station and a fire station, which are brand new. I don't know how many millions you got between the two. If you got, you know, 10, 12 million, whatever it is. There is cameras on both facilities, you know. If we can't police this little tiny exit in front of those facilities, we may as well just hang it up. That's as far as I'm concerned. And this works. It doesn't cost any money. So I'd really appreciate your support to let the selectmen know. I'd like to see if you do it through a motion.
Charlie, let me ask you a question. Since this has direct impact with the Parks and Recreation Department, that's they run that parking lot. It also has an impact on public safety because of the fire station right across the street and the police station. Have you gotten any type of response from either of those organizations with regard to support or not support?
2 Mondays ago is when I came in the selectmen and spoke, and Chief Sawyer came in, and he said that it is worth exploring. And he did say that he supported. Chuck also spoke, and Chuck would say that he, you know, and he agreed with me. I called Chief Ayotte, who spoke to Rich, Chief Sawyer, prior to the meeting, and he said he had no problem with it. Chuck spoke, and he said he agreed in principle. The only concern, I believe, and I can't speak for anybody besides myself, was that they were concerned that someone in Parks said they were worried about cars coming in. So I'm saying, I don't think that's an issue. And I said, that's the only way I disagree in concept. We all agree. And Diana Martin spoke, and that would have been the meeting 2 Mondays ago.
And what did Diana say?
Diane said she pretty much agreed to in concept, but she was worried about staffing and manning. And so I'm saying is, if we can try to do this and the parking lot supervisors can monitor it, you know, Memorial Weekend's probably the best one to start. But if you look at this by choking it down, and you know, you have to look at this also with the chairman of the board, again, I wouldn't speak for him when he spoke Monday, was concerned about traffic going down to Brown and backing up. And I said to him, you could count the times on one hand. It's really the 4th of July that Brown Ave backs up down that four-way between 101 and the police station, where it can conceivably back up. Usually it's coming in, but it can conceivably back up both ways. But at that point, I will bet on anything that every street on that beach is completely clogged. And the chief also said, Chief Sawyer, said that he had never seen the traffic back up going out. He'd seen it back up coming in and queuing on Brown Ave, which we had talked about signalization in the past. And if you look at this exit, now I gave you this, and this is what exists today. All these lines are right here. They're already painted. It's just a matter of adding the Jersey barriers there. Everybody gets a chance to go take a peek at it, and they'll see. But this, I have a picture where it's directly across from what is the handicap ramp for the police station. So it's not directly offsetting the fire station driveway or the precinct exit. So people can easily come out here and take a left, or if they're going to take a right, you know, that's the only place that people queue. So.
Yeah. All right. What I would suggest, if it's to the pleasure of the commissions, that we table this to our 23rd meeting in February. I would just want to make sure that we have a discussion as a commission with public safety and others involved. I'm not challenging, Charlie, what you said, but I'd feel better if we talk to those directly, and then I will put this on the agenda for the February 23rd meeting for a vote of the commission.
Did you look at do not enter signs at the on Brown Avenue side?
What do you do not enter signs? Oh, absolutely. The whole trick to this is signage and choking it down. Obviously, you'd know it's, you know, traffic comma. You got an exit 18 feet wide versus 13.
Yeah,
six.
I know. I mean, those
one way, do not enter.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yep. I think quickest, easiest route to 95.
Oh,
great sign. Well, I think signage is a huge issue down there. We talked about it at the village district lot, is to have signage to send people that way. People just don't know, or they don't pay attention to it.
They don't know.
I agree. It's one thing to think, you know, to think about and look at it. It's another one, like this morning, I said, I got to drive it. So if you come out of that lot, you go 20 feet to a crosswalk, you have to switch lanes, get in the left-hand lane to turn up G Street. You get up the top of G Street, you got the busiest crosswalk in the evenings, and then you got F Street, E Street, D Street. There's actually 13 crosswalks to get to the water tower, and it's a mile. If you go out this way and out Brown Ave, there are two crosswalks that don't get the use of any one of the slowest one up there, and it's a half mile. It's a half the distance, and so it's common sense, but I agree. Everybody should look at it, keep an open mind.
Okay.
One thing Diana said was maybe to pick certain nights to work it, which might be a test thing for casino letting out, getting people out that way. You know, the large concert, fireworks night. I think it's a no-brainer. I mean, at G Street, I live on G Street, on both ends I have property, is completely packed, and then you go to I Street, and that's completely packed because they can't go up G, so they'll go further up to I Street. It would definitely alleviate some of that traffic.
And if I could, Mr. Chair, another thing that I said to the selectman was, I came in a few years ago to the board, and I think I actually brought it up at your board also, to get the town to make this the entrance and the exit. My argument was, not only is it better for traffic, but they'd make more money. That's obviously my opinion, but when you compare apples to apples and take the precinct lot and the town lot, you have facts there, you know? And the precinct lot has far outperformed the town lot. So it's, the other option is, at the time they said that was a money thing because they have to move the booths and stuff, and that's understandable. This, there's no cost. But the other option is that lot could be actually cut in half where they could keep the operation just the way it is on this side, but they could make a smaller lot that would mirror the precinct lot on the other side of the street with a couple of kiosks, and they might find out that they generate more revenue than any parking lot on that beach.
We're taking it from the precinct.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Charlie.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, moving right along. Review and approval of the minutes of the November meeting. Page one. Page two. Page three. You will note under recommendation number one, the letters that are underlined is an edit. Page four, same thing under final. Expanded sidewalks on west side is an edit. We are recommending deleting the possibility of a bathhouse under number four. Page five. Any further edits, comments? Hearing none, I'll take a motion to accept as amended. Motion made by Mr. Merrill, second by Mr. Hausman. Any further discussion? All in favor? Thank you. Next is Treasurer's Report.
Yep, so the account remains as it did in November, $9,994.43. And we also make a motion. We have an invoice for September through December 16, secretarial. For $366.
Motion has been made. Second by Mr. Griffin to pay. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Okay.
Unanimous. Thank you. Thank you, Michael. Mm-hmm. Transportation grant discussion. Although that Mr. Watson is not here, he did have Mr. Rose send me a quick update. That there has been, even though that we haven't seen it, we haven't been involved, there's been a lot of behind-the-scenes work between Williams' staff and VHB to flush out the plans for moving the full transportation grant forward. They are in discussion with VHB in terms of the scope of the next task order, which is actually the design engineering phase. Once the general agreement of the scope is approved, the task matrix is developed and forwarded to DOT. They will take a look at it and then we'll be coming in front of the commission with a draft version of the next task order with all of the itemized tasks, and we'll be seeking the Beach Commission's approval of going forward. So that's the update on the transportation grant. William did not give me an actual timeline, but he indicated that it will be within the next couple of months. Next, old business. Jason. I had asked Jason to quickly give us a quick overview of some warrant articles, once again, that were not Article 10 or 24, but just for the commissioners to know about. Right. So, Jason, if you could just give us a quick overview.
Certainly. So I'll start with the zoning articles. I'll name a couple. We have a total of seven zoning articles, Articles 2 through 8, seven amendments on the agenda. I'll touch upon two of them that I think are of particular significance to the HBSC. One being the accessory dwelling units, Article 2. That's the big one that the planning board had been going over for many months. They've worked hard on that.
But that was prepared in response to Senate Bill 146, which was signed into law of March of 2016, which will be RSA 674:71 through 73. So basically any community that has not adopted zoning by June 1st of this year will be subject to the state law, and only the building permit would be required in single-family zones. So it's very critical that, that this amendment be supported and pass. We've established, the planning board has established local safeguards, including relating to parking, exterior design, a conditional use permit from the planning board, occupancy requirements, and so forth. So critical things that at the local level that are important that help to protect the community with regard to accessory dwelling units. Either way, yes or no, vote. Accessory dwelling units are mandated by the state. So a yes vote would put those local safeguards in place and help protect the community. So we hope that the voters would support that. The other one that I wanted to touch upon is our flood ordinance amendment, Article 5. As this commission knows, I've been involved working on the CRS program items there. I'm working to get the town of Hampton into the CRS, working with our conservation coordinator and the Rockingham Planning Commission. And you get a certain number of points for certain things you do to and enhance into your credit steps. Step 9 gets 5% reduction on insurance premiums. But not to get too much into the CRS right now, but this is an important component of that, that by helping amending our flood ordinances, we can gain some additional points that way. This article is based largely on the state's model floodplain ordinance. Most of the changes are really kind of administrative, kind of housekeeping type changes from what we had, consolidating into one section 2.4, but there are some new items in there as well. And one that has been talked about quite a bit and the planning board supported was elevating newer, substantially improved structures by 1 foot above the base flood elevation. That can get us a minimum of 100 points at CRS by doing that, by having that in our ordinances. The planning board also supported increasing the maximum height of a building by up to 1 foot if such what's called freeboard requirement is implemented. So you'd be credited basically by having to do that. If the maximum height requirement by zoning is 35 feet, you could go up to 36 if you had to provide that freeboard. So there is some compensation for that, and the board thought this was an important amendment as well, and I do too, and I hope the voters would support this one as well. I'll jump ahead to some of the other articles. I mean, there's other smaller housekeeping type changes within our zoning that do affect the beach, but they are really more housekeeping in nature. Chris had talked about Article 10, so we're going to go with that. Article 21 talks about maintenance and reconstruction of streets. Raise and appropriate a sum of $300,000 for that purpose. I imagine that some of that would include the beach area as well. Article 22, raise and appropriate a sum of $25,000 for repair, reconstruction, maintenance, and replacement of sidewalks. And again, I imagine that would incorporate some of the areas down there. 24 was this bicentennial seawall. 33, Article 33 speaks to granting the Board of Selectmen the authority under RSA 41:14A to modify or release deed restrictions imposed by the town under the leased land sales program. Now we know how challenging that can be, having to go to voters every go around for those changes and those deed restrictions. This would give the Board of Selectmen that authority. So that's something that is being considered this year. Article 35 talks about accepting certain streets as Class 5 highways, which are already being paved and maintained by the town for many years. There's no cost to the town in this. I understand this is something that had been going on for many years, and hopefully this list, as I understand it, would address most of what was outstanding, and there are some streets down the beach area that are incorporated into that list. Article 38 talks about the regulating the handling, transportation, and disposal of animal waste. Obviously, people down the beach walking their dogs down there and so forth. Basically, this one thing that this does is it imposes a fine for dumping within the public or private sewer storm drain or storm drainage system, and also incurring the cost of cleanup. People tend to not bag up properly their waste and dispose it in places where they should not be disposing of it, and this is an article that speaks to that. Article 39 is a petition warrant article for 3335 Dover Avenue to permit each of the lots to be sold separately upon the condition that each has deeded right of access to Dover Ave. So my understanding is that restriction number 5 states that those lots must remain in the same ownership and not be sold separately. This would allow them to be sold separately. It's a petition article. Article 42 involves, as we've seen many years, remove deed restriction number 3 regarding the height of ornamental fences to allow no more than 6 feet in height. So many of those leaseland restrictions include that maximum 3-foot height requirement of fencing down the beach, and this is a petition article for that particular property, 11 O Street, to have that struck from their deed. So I think that's pretty much what I flagged for beach-related items. And if there are any questions from anybody.
Anybody have any questions for Jason?
One thing I wanted to mention is about the height of the fencing. It's meant to help hide the trash receptacles also.
Okay.
There's been a lot of people that have been complaining about, they would rather be able to shield some of those things.
Why do we have to keep voting on this every time somebody changes?
I think that there's actually some overlap with one of the other articles here that I had mentioned that talks about giving the Board of Selectmen that authority under 4114A. If you look at that, I think my understanding is something like this would be able to be considered by the Selectmen if that were to pass. But am I correct, Rick, in that?
Yes.
That's what I understand.
The last couple of petitions.
Yeah. With that, it's only the lease land that has that 3-foot fencing. So
that's correct.
Grant?
Yeah, just a clarification on item 5, I think it is.
Okay.
Jason talked about it in a lot of kind of mumbo-jumbo. Really what it is people are in the National Flood Insurance Program. This is beneficial to them. We've got an evaluation system, and it could in fact reduce their premium. So it's a positive in that way.
Stress on that one. That's not just a beach article. All the rivers and everything else.
Oh, absolutely.
Everything in town that has flood insurance is not just a feature.
Right.
It's pretty important that we support
it. It is very important. That's correct.
Yeah, no, I think that's true with a lot of the ones. Like some of the problems that they have with people disposing dog waste in the sewer is not at the beach.
Right, so. And that's what I did. I flagged the ones. They weren't necessarily exclusively for the beach. They were. Mm-hmm. They could be townwide, but they are articles that certainly affect the beach, and I thought they should be brought up.
Any other comments? Mr. Preston.
Yeah. Going back to Article 2, this accessory dwelling.
Yeah.
This is very, very thin ice for a lot of nice neighborhoods in town where they're talking about just putting on an addition for kids that come home, or parents that come home. For it to go through the planning board, I think is critical, to try to keep those neighborhoods looking the way they are rather than just pulling a permit saying, I'm going to do it.
It's not limited to kids and parents. It can
it's
be
everybody.
Anybody.
It is. So I see the need for lots of us to have it. All right? I understand it better than anybody here right now. But it would be much better if we all talked about it, the planning board discussed it and said, well, what's better for, Pickett, Alexander Drive, the west side of town, Edgewood Drive. You want to really know. If you bought into that neighborhood, you want the other houses to remain sort of like yours.
And as I think I noted, the board had spent many months of public meetings that we had noticed on the website when we were having discussions on this topic so that the people could attend and provide their comments over the course of, from basically since the spring, early summer of last year. So it's been a long time in the making. And as soon as we saw that the Senate bill was approved, we got right on it and worked very hard on that.
And Jason made the point earlier, it's going to happen whether we do anything or
right.
not. So what we've done is to, protect the town.
To protect the town, exactly right.
Bob?
I just wanted to give a shout out to Jason, the Conservation Commission, and the Rockingham Planning Commission on the community rating issue for flood insurance premiums. You people have done a ton of work over a long period of time, and we've gone from nowhere to about the 5-yard line. And I hope you can bring it across the goal line. There's an awful lot of benefit to everybody.
For sure.
Yeah. Yeah. And they come to our village district every few months and update us. They've been very cooperative.
Thank you.
Sometimes government is not appreciated.
Okay. Jason, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Next on the old business, progress report partnership with the Hampton Police Department. I'm hoping to get some additional information from Chief Sawyer for our February 23rd meeting. Do not have anything else to update on that one. As I've indicated from the very beginning, if there's anybody, any commissioner would like to put on any type of objectives to the Beach Commission, feel free to do so. Just let me know. As you know, we submitted in our 2016 annual report. Procedure has been that once we submit it in and it's actually printed, then the chairman goes in front of the Board of Selectmen, usually right after the March elections, to basically give an update and also send a letter to the governor with our progress report. So unless anybody has any objections, that will be the plan going forward with regard to the annual report. Any other old business, Michael?
Yeah, just follow up House Bill 302, coupled with Phil Bryce for the 23rd. Not 100% sure he's available to come, but I'll surely let him know that we'll invite him down for that meeting.
Okay.
And then just, you know, a couple things to on the comments there to suggest that that I heard that we're open 12 weeks, then we close our doors. I think it's ridiculous. Our parking operation is 7 months. We're certainly open year-round. Bathrooms, plowing, you know, the sidewalks and things like that. So to suggest that, again, I thought I heard that we hurt businesses by not being open year-round. I'm not sure where that, where that comes from, what it means. You know, we generally say the west side of the street closes, you know, as quickly as the, the summer season ends. So. And also, while the revenues from Hampton certainly go to support other parks, we have more than two or three parks that make money in our system. I think it's 26 parks that are revenue positive for us. So just a couple things to point out in that talk. So.
Okay. And if you can, just check with Phil his calendar.
Yep.
Okay. New business. Once again, Bill was going to bring us up to date, but he did send me a bunch of information, and I'm glad that he did. Once again, the cycle for the 10-year transportation process is already started. The first major step is for any organization, town, entity, to submit in an application to the Rockingham Planning Commission with regard to any additional money that that entity wants to go through the 10-year plan. As you know, right now we have approximately $8 million that's sitting in the 10-year transportation plan. The money becomes available to us starting in 2019. One issue is that we could ask if we think that we're closer to getting some of the transportation grant money to start the construction. We could actually ask for 2018. I would seek Mr. Watson's advice on that. But the deadline of getting in any new money requests to the RPC is on March 3rd. So what my recommendation would be is to seek Mr. Watson's advice on what he would propose for us to do in terms of putting in more than the $8 million right now, or to hold off for a year. But whatever his recommendation is, I would then move forward with the, if necessary, an application, and have it reviewed and prepared to present to you on the 23rd of February, so we can get it into RPC on time. So that would be the update on that. And then finally, on the new business, I had mentioned back in November that I would like to have our legislators, both House representatives and Senator, attend one of our meetings, just to kind of get them to understand who we are and what we do, but also to bring them up to date on some of the things that we are working on that we might need their support down the road. So I will be sending out formal invitations to our legislators to attend our February 23rd meeting. Any objection? Okay. Any other new business?
Yes. I would like to maybe get a consensus from the board on the beach closings. If that's something we want to discuss. There's supposed to be a hearing coming up. Did they set a date, Vic, on the hearing for closing the establishments, restaurants, and businesses?
I think they're trying to do something in the next 30 days. It's pretty much what they said.
I don't know
in the
if
paper,
it's something that we want to take a stand on. The Village District took a motion and unanimously approved to continue. Let me see if I can find it. Motion was made at 1 a.m. closing for all restaurants and retail stores at the beach. We unanimously approved it. Something we want to discuss here, we want to get involved in it.
I think it's very important, and I think that they're aware of the motion that was made, the unanimous motion, and I think that we should encourage everybody that's out there that has, you know, an opinion. They need to come and talk at the meeting. These public hearings that we have are probably the most important thing that can change things. And I haven't really heard anybody that's supportive of that, particularly people from the beach and even people uptown. If they were given a chance to weigh in on it, I don't see that people would think that it's positive.
Just to clarify what Chuck was saying is that, and we were actually copied on a letter sent by Attorney Steve Owls, representing Al Fleury, who is the manager of Wally's, Bernie's Beach Bar, and the Goat. And their request was that Mr. Fleury would like to open up a business to do food sales, but not liquor, for an hour or two past the current deadline of 1 a.m. So that's what Chuck was referring to. I believe it was in the newspaper that it went to the Board of Selectmen. They kind of tabled it for a public hearing. And what is that public hearing? Do you know it?
It's going to be somewhere in about 30 days. Okay. You know, one of the problems is that a lot of people that have issues with, not that this has any issues with Wally, but there's people that have issues with the noise in general. You know, a lot of them aren't here at this time of the year. And it's been a very contentious thing all through the years. I myself am very much in favor of there being some type of a diner or some type of a restaurant. I think it's a great addition, but just not after the 1 o'clock.
Mm-hmm. And it's not just going, if you allow one business, you can't do that. So it's every pizza stand, every sausage stand,
It's every neighborhood.
Every neighborhood will be affected by people in the middle of the night who coming out of the bars. We have to deal with that now, and that's fine. You know, it's done at 1 o'clock, but at 2-3 in the morning, them going out, and then you have the employees at 3 in the morning that leave those places that are going to their cars and going up and down the residential streets, not just the commercial streets. So I think it's something that 1 o'clock has worked as long as I can remember. I don't think we want to
I can tell you what time it is just from listening to cars going up and down Ocean Boulevard without getting out of bed. You know, it's things drop off dramatically at 1 o'clock.
It would seem that it's an issue very appropriate to this commission, which was formed to address issues at the beach over time. And not only would every pizza shop stay open, any bar that served food could stay open, arguably, but not serve liquor after 1 a.m. And that would be an interesting tale in terms of enforcement. And people live in these neighborhoods, and there's a quality of life issue. Down the street over parking on the side streets on the south end of the beach a year ago, and the town entered into some new traffic patterns to help the neighborhoods. The downside just seems to be greater than the upside.
One of the biggest complaints we get are the people going to their cars after they leave work. And if you're leaving work after your place closes at 3 o'clock, then it brings it up to 4 o'clock, 4:30 in the morning. It just seems like it never ends. And these people that work in these establishments all park on residential streets. Well, maybe not all of them, but a vast majority of them.
A big portion of it, yeah.
Any other comments?
If you want to put it on the agenda for the next meeting, we can discuss it longer if you want. I think briefly, if you asked Rich Sawyer what he thought, I think he'd tell you that one or two, he's letting his officers go home. The complement of police officers on the street is a lot less at 3 o'clock if they needed help. So I don't think he'd be in favor of it, but I'm sure he'll testify.
Well, do we want to take a position before the public hearing? Unless there's a public hearing, there could be a decision made at the public hearing.
I think there should be someone here from the public, for someone from here at the public hearing.
But if it's 30 days, you said it's 30 days from now?
3 weeks. Three days.
So is it after the 23rd commission meeting?
Well, it'll be 30 days.
Oh, so 30 days from the board meeting?
From Monday. It could be the 20th. I'm hoping they don't do it the week after, as it's school vacation week, so there's a lot of people that aren't around.
Yeah, and these are things that we're going to take into consideration. It hasn't really come up. It probably will come up again this week, and maybe we'll firm up a date.
So maybe we should have
a motion.
Make a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to continue 1 o'clock closing at Hampton Beach and support Chief Sawyer's recommendations.
Second.
I'm confused. What did you say about Sawyer?
Well, maybe he could give us some insight or something, but I would like to continue. I'd like to continue at 1 o'clock. I'll drop that.
That's cool.
Sorry.
So, and I'll second that.
Motion was made to continue the 1 o'clock closing for all establishments at Hampton Beach. Do I have a second?
I second it.
All right. Mr. Griffin? Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of Chuck's motion? Opposed? Abstained? One abstention? Okay, Michael.
But by the time you get back to Concord after leaving at 3 o'clock, it would really be late. You'd be trying to come back to work.
I'm not looking for that.
Any other new business? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn. Mr. Preston made a motion. Mr. Merrill seconded. All in favor? Aye. Channel 22, thank you very much.
No problem.
Michael?
I was going to vote for Merrill.
I'm trying to say another word, John.